Thank you very much. Hello, everyone. I am Daniel White, also known as danooct1 in certain online circles. My talk tonight is about the old virus culture. And a lot of people, when they ask me, when they first hear about my YouTube stuff, they ask me, why are you doing this? Well, the main reason is that I got infected with a global worm called Sasser in 2004. Now, this worm led to a dialogue that you see here, which crashed the system process and your computer would reboot every 60 seconds endlessly until you removed the worm. So that got me fascinated. I read up about it, and I realized there were way more of this stuff. So I kept reading, read everything I could. And eventually, I found a couple samples for my own and decided, well, I can pivot these myself, but I'd like to put them up on YouTube. And I decided to make videos. I didn't expect anybody to be interested, and now, well, here we are. So malware nowadays is distinctly different from what we see in the past. So this is an example of a malware called CryptoLocker, which some of you may have heard of. This was in the past couple of years. This virus, this Trojan infects your computer through a Trojan horse. You expect it to be something else. It encrypts your documents, your pictures, your videos, and then demands a ransom for them. And if you don't, it'll destroy the public key that encrypted them, and you cannot get your files back. And these guys made a lot of money, on the order of several hundred million dollars.
Wow.
So malware back then was a very different game, as I said. So who was the average malware author in the 80s and 90s? Well, usually teenagers, early 20s. These were basically hobbyist programmers. They did this because they felt like they wanted to make something. A lot of these were a test of their own skills. So when they make these viruses, they want to push themselves to limits and see what they can make. And a lot of them had fun with it. So you can see this is a virus called Marsland, also known as Spanska. And it has a VGA effect of a scrolling sort of Mars land with various hills and valleys. And as he says, coding a virus can be fun. In an interview, he mentioned that coding a virus that destroys your hard drive is nothing but a few lines of code and anybody can do it. But coding something that is truly beautiful actually takes skill. And so that's why he made viruses. So in addition to this, these hobbyists got together and formed groups. So these groups would often war with each other and war with antivirus companies. One such group, as you see here, is called Nuke. There's also groups like Falcon Schism, and also 29A is a very prolific virus software group. And often in their code, they would leave hidden comments either to each other, to members of their own community, members of other virus communities, or members of the antivirus researching community, telling them various things, taunting them, making fun of them, telling them they suck, etc. And another question I get is, a lot of these computers weren't connected to the internet. A lot of people didn't have regular internet access. They mainly worked in an offline mode. And how did you get infected? Well, virus author would upload his virus somewhere. He'd infect a popular program that was out, maybe like Microsoft Word or a game like Doom. And people would want that game, so we put it up on a pirate BBS board. Now, BBS is a bulletin board system where people could connect to it. It's like an online forum and download repository. People could download files. And these pirate ones were a lot like torrents today, where you can illegally download programs. And so you wouldn't know that this was infected by a virus. So you run the game would work pretty well, and it would last for a while, and then eventually your hard disk would be overwritten. Fine. So you get this game, you don't know it's infected, you play it for a while, and your friend finds out you have the game. So you're like, yeah, I'll give that to you. You give him a copy of the game on your floppy disk. Your friend gets infected. He infects his friends, so on and so forth. You take the game to work, you play a game on your computer, you infect the word network, propagates over the word network, affects a bunch of computers there, and overwrites all your company data, and your company goes out of business. And eventually, what we're familiar with nowadays is through the internet email. So you can see the image here. This is the love letter worm that came out about 15 years ago and infected millions and millions of PCs. As you kind of checked the love letter coming from me, you ran an infection, and it overwrote your MP3s and your documents with the worm and spread itself further. So basically, a lot of people also ask, what were the goals of these virus authors? So a lot of viruses simply spread. They didn't have any activation routines like a payload or anything like that. They didn't display graphics. They just infected files and got as far as they could as fast as they could. Some were made to annoy the user. They would get in your face. They tell you that you suck. They interrupt your work with various hilarious messages. Some had complex graphics, like you saw the Spanska virus was a VGA effect. There was others doing similar stuff like this. Others wanted to create as destructive a virus as they possibly could. So they would do as much as they could to delete your data or destroy your computer. And probably the most destructive virus was known as Chernobyl in 1998. It infected Windows 95 and 98 computers, and when it went off on April 26th, which was the date Chernobyl exploded, it would attempt to overwrite your basic input output system with BIOS of your computer, and when that happened, your computer does not boot anymore. So you have to reflash a chip on your motherboard to fix that. And some others like to go through unique methods of infections on the affected files. And I'll explain that in just a bit. So these are some viruses that you'll see in this exhibit and one that you won't. So Pro-E Life is right over here on this wall. This virus is a sort of a biting commentary about the pro-life, pro-choice debate. It tells you to stop killing the baby viruses and overwrites your antivirus program so that when you run it, it displays this aborted code.
Oh no!
Yep. And it has a bunch of slogans and images from earlier viruses of the day. You can see the ambulance virus in the bottom there. That would display across your screen when that virus went off. We have Cascade, which is on the back end of this wall. Cascade was just a rather silly virus. It wasn't destructive, it didn't overwrite anything. But every few seconds, as you use your computer, all the letters would collapse in a heap on the bottom of the screen. This is Casino, it's right here on this wall at the front. And this game was destructive, and it made you play a game of jackpot for your data. This virus goes off, it writes everything on your hard drive into RAM, and then corrupts it, and tells you you have to play this game. And if you don't win, and it's very hard to win, it will delete everything in the RAM and your Wi-Fi. If you do win, it tells you to go away and not use your computer until tomorrow so that the virus won't go off again. And finally, this virus is not in this exhibit, but this is an example of an interesting file infector called Shifter. Now, a lot of these, all these viruses here are called file infectors, in that when you run a program on your computer, such as a game, the virus will intercept that you're trying to run a program, write a little routine at the beginning of it to patch itself in at the end. So when you run the program, it'll jump to the virus code that's written in at the end, run the virus, and then jump back to your regular program and run that. So, Shifter does stuff a little differently. This is what I call a very unique virus. So when you're programming in assembly, when you are assembling your code, you have a .asm file. When you assemble it, it assembles into a .obj file, which you then link into an executable. And what this virus does is it intercepts any attempts to assemble ASM files so that the resulting obj file will have a copy of the virus in it, so that every program you assemble with that will end up having a copy of Shifter as well, and it ended up displaying this message, which is a good example of the greetings to various other people in Falcon Schism and Nuke, as you can see. Alright, and now, a little special live demo of a couple of viruses. This is what I do on my channel all the time, because it's super fun. Sure. Normally, DOS computers don't do this. But when you have an i7, it's pretty easy. So today I have three viruses. This one is called Lunchtime. Now it doesn't play nice with infecting files. It has a nasty habit of corrupting the operating system. So we're not going to infect any files with it. We're just going to run it and see the effect. And it goes off at noon every day. And this is a message in Polish that tells you you are working very hard and you need to take a lunch break. And it tells you it has encoded your hard drive and will delete everything if you reset before 2 p.m. So you can either wait out the time or you can call its bluff and reset anyway, in which case you find out it didn't actually delete. Alright, and now we have a virus called Burrows. Now this one I can show you infecting files, which a lot of people find pretty interesting. So what I like to do is show a file that hasn't been infected. So this is a DOS file that helps you print from a graphics file called graphics.com. Now its regular size, as you can see, is 19742 bytes. So when we run this file, Verotes will take effect and infect it. And that happened pretty quick, as you can see. But if we look at the file again, you can see the Verotes has run itself to the end of it, as the file size is now 21,052. So this will happen with all the .com files on your machine. Switch to the day it activates, which is the 5th of January, and reset. We will see what it does. So we'll go ahead and run that file that we infected. You get big color bars on the screen. Great. And it stays on top of everything. You continue using your computer, but you can't see anything. Trying to run some programs, they tend to crash and not work very well. One last thing, I can actually show you a couple of the comments that the virus author left in it. This is from the Italian boy virus, as you see over here. If we just take a quick look at it, Italy is the best country in the world, is what it displays, and F's to Italian virus killers is its message to antivirus vendors. So as you can see, they got pretty vulgar with it. So that's about all I have for this presentation. So thanks very much for watching.
All right, Daniel, thank you very much for this demo. If you want to see more, go on YouTube, check out his channel. It's called danooct1. If you want to know how that's spelled, just ask him directly. Our next